Brother Sikri, Dr. Chauhan, dear Mr. Vaseen, respected professors and teachers of law, my dear students. In the argument of points of law that are taking part in the moots, it is heartening that a few eminent law colleges like Amity Institute of Law are offering a variety of courses designed to teach students particularly lawyering skills and to stimulate in the classroom the settings in which lawyers do their work. The most common examples are the moot courts and the practice experiences. It has to be remembered that the lawyers, judges, students and teachers of law, all of us, are partners in a great adventure, that is the adventure of administering justice. Lawyers and judges are really trustees for the litigants who come to the courts, either for vindication of their constitutional rights, private rights or civil rights, and therefore the task to be approached with deep consciousness of the fact and with a sense of responsibility. The profession of law is a very noble profession. Unfortunately, throughout the ages, lawyers and judges have been figures of satire and caricature at the hands of various authors right from ancient days. Mr. Vaseen said that if you have nothing else to do, probably you do okalati. There is a saying in my state that if you have nothing else to do, you do homeopathy, rajniti or okalati. Very attractive alternatives. In the Roman times, the poet Marcel described lawyers as men who hire out their words and anger. The passion with which they argue in the courts shows the anger for which they are hired. Coming to the Middle Ages, Chaucer, in his prologue to Canterbury Tales, poked sly fun at the man of laws. Then we come to the most quoted description of lawyers by Dean Swift in Gulliver's Travels, in which lawyers are described as a society of men among us, bred up from the youth in the art of proving by words multiplied for that purpose that white is black and black is white according to as what they are paid. And probably somebody said in a lighter vein that that is why the lawyers wear the black coat and the white pant, depending on which side is more attractive and is more lucrative. An American humorist, Mencken, described a judge as a law student. My dear Arjun will not take offense if I say it. A judge as a law student who sets and marks his own examination papers and invariably gives himself first class first. Today, the task of the judges, lawyers, law students and teachers have become very different from what it was in the earlier days because the emphasis was on private rights. Today, in the changed society, emphasis is on constitutional rights, on public rights, on rights which have been conferred upon the weaker and disadvantaged societies. What was taught to me during my law college days has today become obsolete so far as practice of law is concerned. Speaking on the topic reminds me of what a great American judge of the Supreme Court of United States, Mr. Justice Felix Frankfurter, has stated. A young schoolboy named Clausen is at about 12 years living in the city of Alexandria, opposite to Washington DC, where the Supreme Court of the United States is situated on the other bank of the river Potomac, wrote to Justice Frankfurter that he had a great desire to go in the field of law, and he sought his advice how he should prepare and equip himself for the study of law. What Justice Frankfurter replied, I would request every student of Amity Law College and every student of law to remember. He said, my dear Paul, no one can be truly competent lawyer unless he is a truly cultivated man. If I were you, I would forget all about any technical preparation for the law. The best way to prepare for the law is to come to the study of the law as well as as a well-read person. Thus alone can one acquire the capacity to use the English language on paper and in speech and with habits of clear thinking, which only a truly liberal education can give. No less important for a lawyer is the cultivation of the imaginative faculties by reading poetry, seeing great paintings in the original or in easily available reproductions, and listening to good music. I once told Mr. Lalit Bhasin, when he had organized a musical program, that probably Mr. Lalit Bhasin is such a successful lawyer because he is fond of good music. Stock your mind with the deposit of much good reading and widen and deepen your feelings by experiencing vicariously as much as possible the wonderful mysteries of the universe and forget all about your future career. Justice Frankfurter wrote the letter several decades ago. Today even something more is necessary for making a competent lawyer or a competent judge. That is the knowledge of business, commerce and something of economics, of socio-economic problems, of political philosophies. You must have knowledge of bookkeeping and of accounts. You must be acquainted with various activities of life which someday or the other would come to a court of law, because today legislation regulates almost every branch and activity of human life, and where there is legislation, there must generally be litigation. There can be no excellence in law without excellence in lawyers. Chief Justice Warren Burger of the United States expressed his belief that about one half of America's practicing lawyers are not adequately qualified to represent their clients, and he added that the incompetence of lawyers is one of the major reasons for delays in courts. The Chief Justice further stated that some United States lawyers do not even know how to ask a question in court. Others object to everything, he said, giving the example of a lawyer who explained, oh, that is a leading question. When a witness was asked, is your name Mr. Goldman? Oh, that was also treated as a leading question. One of the reasons for incompetence of so many lawyers is the incredible and ever-increasing complexity of law. The legal profession requires a capacity for hard work and far above the ordinary. When an anxious mother asked Lord Thurlow whether he would advise her son to take up law as a profession, the reply was, Madam, can your son work like a horse and live like a hermit? Lord Reading made a memorable quip when he joined the bar. He thought that it would be a bed of roses, but he soon discovered that it was either all roses and no bed, or all bed and no roses. Certain ideals and values which open up a larger meaning to human existence will always be beyond the pale of law, and that is why a lawyer has to be well versed in other subjects if he deserves to aim at excellence. Somebody, a very famous poet, had written, the law the lawyers know about is property and land, but why the leaves are on the trees, and why the waves disturb the seas, why the honey is the food of bees, why horses have such tender knees, why winters come when rivers freeze, why faith is more than what one sees, and hope survives the world's worst disease, and charity is more than these, they do not understand. It is a matter of great concern that legal education has not received the attention it deserves. But fortunately, colleges like the Amity Law School have proved that there can be excellence in law teaching, and I entirely agree with the suggestion that the law teachers should be equipped, and not only equipped, they should be also well paid, and I am happy that the Amity Institution is precisely doing that. Today, unfortunately, there is a big gap between what lawyers are expected to do in certain areas and what is actually done. The basic difference can be treated to inadequate legal education and entry of unqualified, ill-equipped lawyers into the profession. My advice to the students is simply this. As my dear brother Arjun said, your duties to the society are many. You are the present and future intellectual torchbearers of the society. People are bound to look up to you for leadership, guidance, advice and assistance. Do not hesitate to offer your service to society whenever it is possible to do so. Do not think that you have no time. A busy man finds time for everything, and you have a role model in Dr. Ashok Chauhan. A lazy man cannot find time for anything. You have, however, to equip yourself for the great tasks which lie before you. You must study human life in all its aspects. You should attend to the economic and social welfares. You must have faith in yourself. Do not feel frustrated if you do not get early success. Depend on your inner capacity and on your moral fiber. Do not allow adversity and temporary obstacles to kill your enthusiasm. Success comes to those who dare and act. You have great opportunities. Please do not allow them to lapse. Before coming to an end, I must tell you something which, of course, has been said in a lighter vein. In a court of law, a senior lawyer was addressing the lawyer appearing for the other side as Mr. Necessity. When this went on for some time, the presiding judge reminded the lawyer that the name of the counsel was not Mr. Necessity but something else. The senior lawyer politely said, "Your Honor, I know his name, but I am only repeating the saying that necessity knows no law." And reminding him that he doesn't know law, I am very sure students of the Amity Institute, or for that matter any law college, will not have the rare privilege of being addressed as Mr. Necessity. Those who are to participate in the competition need not feel disheartened even if they do not win prizes. In courts also, lawyers, however eminent, do not win all cases in which they appear. It is only that they carry out their professional duties ably and efficiently. That is what is important. You must give your best. The sense comes from dedication, sincerity and hard work. Now, before I end, I must make a comparison between two persons, eminent persons on the dais, Dr. Birappa Moily and Mr. Ashok Chauhan. They are both persons with a mission, persons with a vision, persons with compassion, but at the same time, persons with no tension. And they have one thing in common. Dr. Chauhan is building up the foundation for a good judicial system by providing the best education in law. And Dr. Birappa Moily is doing his best to build up on that foundation greater values for the lawyers, the judges, and all those who are associated with law. It's not a small thing. Both of them are dreamers, but not ordinary dreamers, dreamers with a vision, and that is what is necessary. I think I have told you enough about what is law about and what law students should do. I would just end by repeating what Arjun had said about a coincidence of 1999. When I came to the Delhi High Court in 2000, the first judge who attracted my notice was the baby of the court, Arjun Sikri. And then I told him that you look more like a college student than a judge. And interestingly, after a few days after we joined, I asked Arjun, let's go and visit the courts, whether our judicial officers are coming to court regularly, attending to court work regularly. He said, Chief, why are you asking me? Because I said, mostly you practiced in the High Court, so lawyers there would not be knowing you. And in any event, people will not mistake you to be a judge. They will say some young student has come with his elder brother to do something in the court for an affidavit or something. Lo, behold, exactly that thing happened. We went in Arjun's private car and moved around the courts, noticed what were the difficulties. 99 he became a judge. 99 the Amity Law College was built up, and his son joined in 99 in Amity, and I became a Chief Justice in 1999 in two courts. In 99 September, actually I joined as the Chief Justice of the Kerala High Court. So to the number of candles that Arjun has proposed, that three candles should be there for the birthday, I would like two more to be added for me. Let there be five candles so that we can all celebrate and wish a very happy return of the day for the Amity Institution. You have already 60,000 students in your rolls. In your future, let it turn to at least a lakh of lakh of students. I think that would be a good number to begin with. Thank you very much.